everyone. Thanks for taking the time to join us this morning. You've got myself, Alex and Paul.
Hi, everyone.
Morning, everyone.
Just letting people in, but I thought we'd start on time. So welcome to our talk today. It's a little less conversation, a little more action, which Paul just had a little bit of Elvis blast in there on the music. So today we're going to take you through what we've been doing at Covéa Digital, our strategy, what's been working for us, what we've learned, what our challenges is. So I'm going to hand over now to the guys so we can introduce ourselves.
So I'll start off. So I'm Alex Schofield. I'm a technical engineering manager at Covéa Insurance. I've actually been with the organisation for longer than I care to admit, which is 22 years. Had a number of roles across that time, and actually been part of the engineering leadership for the last 7 years. It's been a bit of a roller coaster. And we'll go through some of those things as we run through where we are and what we're trying to do at Covéa Engineering.
Awesome. I'm Kathleen. I am a technical engineer manager here at Covéa. I've been at Covéa now since around March. So I've been, I joined and then was straight into lockdown. So I've been spent most of the time at home. Before I joined Covéa as a technical engineer manager, I actually was a business analyst working on analysis and consultancy. So a little bit of a different background to technical engineering.
And I'm Paul Pilling. I joined Covéa just around a year ago. My background also isn't really in tech, but I've been a scrum master, agile delivery manager, product owner, jack of all trades, master of none, some might say.
So one of the first things that we wanted to talk through is some of the things that have happened at engineering and within Covéa Digital specifically. We basically have a fairly new leadership team. We formed when our head of engineering, Mick Holden, joined us around 16 months ago. And from then, we've had a real push around understanding what engineering is and how we make it better for everyone in engineering. In true agile fashion along the way, we've made some mistakes. We're not afraid to admit that we've made mistakes. And we'd like to just share some of those with you just to show where we've been on our journey, what's happened and what we've had to learn from. So I'll just run through those a few examples quickly for you. So the first thing that we did, we started some stand-ups, and that was for the leadership team to really understand in true fashion, you know, what we were looking at, focus, update, what our blockers were, where we needed to get to. We called that the development wall, and our strap line was to make engineering great again. So it was done on, and it was a real parody for something that was in the news quite a lot at that point. Unfortunately, what we saw were some reactions of people that didn't really appreciate the fact that although it was a parody, we were potentially showing that we believed in some of President Trump's values. So we quickly had to reform around that idea, and we took everything off. That was probably our first major learning point as a newly formed engineering leadership team. From that, we were looking at trying to make the environment more fun for our people. You know, engineering can be sometimes seen as quite a dull thing. I'm hugely passionate about the fact that engineering isn't dull. So we wanted to try and enable our people to have a little bit more fun at work. We wanted them to really enjoy coming into work and know that we were going to support them through that. So we introduced the concept of chief fun officers, or CFOs as we called them, across our sites. Again, there was lots done in this space. You know, we had lots of events, we had lots of silly prizes, from sweets to whoopee cushions. We did an awful lot, but again, there were a minority that felt that we were trying to force fun on them. So we kind of lost our focus about making our people individuals. It wasn't about forcing people to have fun. It was about giving people the opportunity, and the communications we saw didn't really get that point across. So we learned a lot from that as well. And on that, we also saw our other colleagues, so from product, from delivery, from service. We were running an awful lot of things in the middle of in the office. Those chapters or communities, whatever you'd like to call them, their people saw us taking engineering out of delivery. They saw us having fun. They saw us investing. And they started asking questions, really simple ones like, couldn't you just have given us a heads up that you were going to do that in front of all our people so that we could do something similar? So again, it comes back to that communication around, you know, what we're doing, making sure we're being seen as being a collaborative force rather than just going and doing something for engineering and only engineering. So we've learned quite a lot over the last 18 months. And the thing that I've learned of being part of that is it's okay to fail. You know, we have that embedded in our leadership team. We have that embedded in our people. It's okay to fail and learn from those failures. I suppose the thing to finish on this slide is, after all, don't we inspect and adapt in a true agile organization? That's all we're trying to do. Okay. So before I move on to the next slide, what we want to do is try and have a little bit of interaction with you guys. It's okay us talking through our journey and where we are on that journey and what we're doing. We're really interested at getting some interaction with you guys to help us understand if you're feeling the same pain around your organisation. So if you haven't noticed already, there is a link to a Slido in the comments. If you'd like to go and access that Slido, we'd really love some interaction with you at this point. So I'll just give you a few seconds to go and find that. Has everybody been able to access that? And give us a thumbs up in the comments if you have. Not seen the link. Let us post that again for you. So I've just posted it again in the comments for you.
If you go onto Slido, the poll number is #16623 as well, for anyone that might be going via the phones or whatever.
So just while you're all trying to access that, one of the we've seen an awful lot from a digital transformation perspective. Covéa Digital is now really pushing towards our digital transformation strategy. I'm sure there are an awful lot of other organisations out there that are doing the same. We have, I suppose, whether we call them blockers or obstacles, whatever you want to call them, where we've hit a few, we know where our pain points are. We're really interested to understand if you're seeing the same. So if you could just go and let us know what kind of things you found from a digital transformation perspective or any transformation perspective. It'd be really handy for us to understand if we're in the same boat or there are other things that we need to focus on as we move forward from where we are at the moment.
And also, if anyone's got any questions, they can put them on that Slido as well. And we'll try and make some time at the end to run through those.
We've already got our first question.
Sweet. It's working. Technology, marvellous. You just let me know when you want me to move on to the next slide, Alex.
Hopefully everybody's had a chance to get involved in that now. So move on now, please, Paul.
Certainly.
So where were we? We engineering as a function. Again, Mick came in and really started to challenge a few of us around how are we going to enable not only a culture where we are delivering for our organization, but we're also enabling our people to see that they want to come and work at Covéa Insurance. They want to stay with us, we're going to invest in them. And we quickly saw that the foundations that we probably felt were in place were probably not the right foundations for our people. So we did quite a lot of work over a period of time to understand what the organization wanted from an engineering function, what we needed from an engineering function, and also tried to understand what our people wanted from their own careers. And that led us to a review of capabilities. Now, we had a capability that was very strong. But it was all focused on our current live services. That's where our focus was. We were trying to deal with legacy systems, some of which are 22 years old, and I'm sure there's lots of people on this call that are probably in the same position. What we weren't actually doing is really focusing on what capability we needed to help Covéa Digital and Covéa as an insurance company move forward and really challenging the market. So what we found was that the structure that we had in place at that point probably wasn't the right structure that we needed to help push Covéa Insurance forward. And due to that, we actually completed a restructure. Now that restructure enabled us to set our people's focus on emerging technologies more. And I'll come on to that in a couple of slides, whilst also allowing us to run our organization and run our live systems. And we also introduced a leadership layer that was there to help build that capability. As a lead engineer previously, I didn't really get the time to be able to understand how I could build a better engineering capability that would help Covéa Digital. So we introduced a layer of management that helped us to do that. Following that that restructure, it also enabled us to start empowering our people. We did this through building guilds and engineering guilds. We actually never had successfully established a guild for engineering. We've done that now. We've seen an awful lot of benefit from the guild, whether it's just people who are cross-site who are meeting to talk more, whether it's more effective communication, or whether it's real collaborative working between an engineering function that had been siloed previously. So a really quick example, we were using Swagger in a lot of our deliveries. We were using it in four different ways. We asked our engineering guild to have a look at that. Within 3 days, they'd aligned that our use of Swagger across all of our technologies where it was required. And it was really pleasing to see that, because previously we probably didn't give the guys enough space or enough support to be able to do those kinds of things. And there's lots of other things that have come out of those guilds as well. We've asked the guys to start expanding on our engineering playbook. So the playbook is something that enables us to tell a story about what engineering is, what the culture is, what technologies we use, you know, what we're looking for in our people. And these kinds of things we're allowing to expand now into, these are the kinds of things that we show to our new starters. You know, everybody gets has to have a HR induction, but not everybody gets to really understand the detail of their role. So we're expanding on those things. And one of the main things about the restructure, and when, again, we'll touch on this later, it gave some really good succession paths that we never had before. So we really started to build those foundations from an engineering layer upwards. And that's it on that slide.
So team, Alex spoke about there the engineering leadership team and how it started to form. And one of the key things that you're probably thinking is, for engineering leadership, surely they must all be, you know, from a tech background, or they all must have been engineers. But, you know, I'll let you into a secret. One of the key ingredients for our success is that we've got an engineering leadership team from diverse backgrounds. So we're not all just techies. We actually come from, we've got analysis, we've got agile delivery, we've got product, we've got people in marketing, we've got people from like a UX background, and we've got people that kind of disrupt the market and come back in with those opinions and views and challenge points. And I think the key here for us and how we flourished as a team is we're able to challenge each other. We're able to have a problem come in, and it's not just one perspective. So if you've got a group of the same people, you're not going to be able to do that challenge in the same way. And that really is one of the key things that we've allowed ourselves and the engineering capability to do, is set ourselves up for success, because each of us can offer our own perspectives. We can challenge each other. We can actually learn from each other. And we're effectively taking our leadership and our teams to the next level, because having that diverse set of people in a team also sets the example for other people as well. You know, for the teams that we work with, you know, one of our leadership at the moment is looking at how we disrupt the market within insurance. And through that, it's not just about the technology, it's about the people side of things as well. So we've got different people able to balance those different views. I think without a diverse leadership team, you might fall into the pattern of having I-shaped people. So whenever we talk about different shaped people, we've got I-shaped people or T-shaped people or E-shaped people. And if we just had I-shaped people, then chances are you're going to miss things. So you might be too tech focused, or you might be too focused on people. And I think that is one of the key to our successes, is we're able to bring both of those together. So you'll find the trend of this talk is actually bringing both the technical excellence and the growth and the culture of our people together through that leadership team to bring better results.
So Kathleen's just touched on this slide. Paul, if you just show all of this, I'll run through it at the same time. So I suppose one thing, as techies, everybody loves a bit of technology. What we want to do is balance our technical capabilities with our culture capabilities. But what we are really passionate about is where we've managed to get to from a technical capability perspective. So I won't run through these all at once, or one at a time, should I say. But I'll give you a summary of where we are at the moment from a technical capability perspective. We're looking at building a diverse and exciting technical capability at Covéa. It's absolutely key for us, not only as engineers, but to help Covéa Insurance move forward, that we have that diverse technical capability. There are a number of things that are ongoing within our delivery teams at the moment, and without that diverse technical capability, we wouldn't be able to deliver them. So the slide features a number of technical capabilities that we're growing, and it's really exciting as a techie to look at some of these and understand, you know, what is it that floats our boats? Is it a bit of everything? Is it one language? Is it one application? So a few examples of what we're on with at the moment. We're actually building microservices in Node and .NET Core. And we've been doing this now for 12 months. One of the things that we're really keen to establish is that autonomy of decision making within the guys. So we're not actually going to tell one of our engineering teams, you have to use Node or you have to use .NET Core. What we're trying to build as an engineering function is the capability for those teams to spin up a microservice to deliver the right value for anything that we are being asked to deliver. Because we trust our people to understand which language will deliver that for us. We're here to help support build those capabilities. We did not have those capabilities within this organization 18 months ago. We have a number of microservices that are already built and ready to productionize in those languages now. We're challenging our delivery pipelines. CI/CD is still a hot topic. It has been for some time, but we're looking to embed that philosophy into our teams. That ultimately leads to us delivering more value quicker, but it also gives us opportunities to learn. It's still relatively new to our organization, I'd say. We've had to pivot quite a few times around what the best CI/CD pipeline looks like, but there are tools now that we've embedded that are going to help that. You can see on here, we've got GitLab, we've got Jenkins, we've got SonarQube. That's not to say that they will be the weapons of choice going forward, but that gives us the ability to build those pipelines and see if we need to inspect and adapt and make some changes in future. We're also reviewing opportunities to allow our organization to have a configurable layer, as I will call it. Lots of debate around what configuration means, I think, from an engineering perspective, and we could probably speak about that for some time. But this is about working with our organization and those outside of IT and our internal customers more freedom to make changes without breaking our live services. And let's be honest, as engineers, I don't really want to make a change to some wording on an email somewhere that somebody else could do on our behalf. So we're really looking to get that work into the guys that should be doing it, that will enable us to deliver value quicker. So I suppose in short, we've introduced a number of technology options over the last 18 months, which should work hand in hand with the work that we're doing to improve culture. It makes it a really exciting place to be. I mean, the amount of variation from the work that my guys are doing from a business operational systems perspective, we're looking at how we can utilize Node and .NET Core microservices to help start to decommission some of the legacy technologies that we've got. It's a really exciting place to be. Even in our other delivery teams where they're not dealing with integrating with legacy, there's so much going on from a technical perspective and so much learning happening that it really is a really exciting place to be at the moment from a technical perspective.
So we talked about the tech and we've talked about how we've started our journey in the foundations and how we've changed. But one of the key things that we are making sure that we address at the same time is the culture. So making sure that the culture is right and set up in the right way and keeps emerging and keeps evolving as well as our technical capabilities is key to making sure we deliver excellent engineering practice. So once some of the things that we've done, you know, Alex alluded to earlier, we've got some sites in other areas. So we've made sure that we engage with those sites. We've tried to, you know, with the chief fun officers and things like, we've tried to experiment with different ways to make sure that people in our other, across all three sites that we have, are understanding of who we are, what we're doing, and we're all doing things in a similar type way. We're not trying to create robots of people. That's not what we're trying to do. We're just trying to give people the autonomy and the freedom to be able to develop and grow in the way that they see fit and is best for them. So we've done a lot of initiatives around that. So we've done a lot of, you know, your standard sort of health checks around what are the problems that people face. And we've had several initiatives to try and address those, like, you know, Operation Kermit was one of the great things that we did, where we took a lot of feedback from our lead engineers and our engineers to find out what were the challenges they had, and we tried to address some of those, not by making sweeping changes from a leadership point of view, but by engaging with them to find out how's best to for us to make to overcome those problems. And I think that's one of the key things that, as Kathleen mentioned before, is about the leadership being a diverse group of people coming together as a team with technical capabilities and different backgrounds, is the fact that we now, rather than just tackle it from one point of view, we tackle it from a wider scope. So we don't just look at tools to fix the problem, we look at tools and people together and how we use those. Another thing that we're trying to also do is make sure that we're not seen as an IT engineering function that sits over the side and then delivers whatever technology people need. It's about making us open and available to people within the business. So, you know, a successful transformation doesn't happen in the business without IT and engineering, and it doesn't happen just in engineering. It has to be the whole organization together. And we're trying to make sure that people know who we are as engineers. We're not some people sat in a cupboard coding in the dark. We want to, you know, we're not that type of IT crowd type people. We are open and, you know, Alex, I've not got my video on because obviously I'm scarier than most people, but, you know, there's different ways we can do that and make sure that, you know, we are pushing the boundaries of how we do that. And one thing that's been really important in doing that is giving our engineers a voice. So not representing them when not needed, but giving them the understanding that they have the power, they have the capability. If they want to get up and challenge something, then they can do that. If they need us to represent them, then we'll help and we'll coach them and guide them in how best to challenge. But it's about taking that veneer of a developer off people and making them software engineers. So they're not just there to code, they're there to challenge and to deliver the best product and deliver the best code to meet the outcome. And I think that's been something that through the formation of the guilds and the chapters is also giving our engineers the voice, where they're in their own comfort area in the guild and they can go to that guild and they can bring an idea. So everyone in that guild, you know, whether they be a junior engineer or an experienced software engineer with 20 years experience like Alex, you know, they can have a equal voice in that guild, and then we can grow that confidence, and then they can speak to the business and do that in the right way. And that is, I think, a really key focus area that we are still working on and we need to keep embedding within our culture. And I think it's fair to say we've still made mistakes. We're not perfect yet. And to be honest, that's brilliant. Because if we were perfect, then we'd be out of a job. And if we are perfect, then we're doing something massively wrong if we think that we've cracked it already. We need to keep making mistakes. That's why agile and iterative development is so good, is that you can make the mistakes, you learn from them, you grow, and you make yourselves better. If we could sit here now and say, we've cracked it and we're the best and you should follow our model, then we'd be lying to you, to be frank. You know, everyone knows the Spotify models out there. No one follows the Spotify model. It doesn't work. It worked for a moment in time for a company. What we're trying to share is that it's fine to make mistakes as long as you have that supportive culture and leadership in place to make sure that people want to try and make mistakes. People want to try and experiment. People want to try and push the boundaries, because we can't disrupt insurance market if we don't. If we just stick to this nice and safe way to do stuff, we are not going to succeed in our mission. So, Kathleen.
Yeah, so I was going to say there, so what does the future look like then? So the first thing, you know, it's one of the headlines that we've got on the opening talk, which is, you know, a little less conversation, a little bit more action. And this quote's a really good one, because it really is now, you know, take a step back, slow down in order to enable yourself to speed up. we can make the future whatever it is that we want it to be, but we, in order to do that, we need to take action. A lot of people will talk about the things that, you know, we should do this, we should do that. I think one of the key things to our success is, as Paul and Alex have said, there is, we're not afraid to fail. We're not afraid to put our hands up and say, yeah, do you know what, that didn't work out. We know that we're not perfect, but the fact is we've taken action, so we're further forward. We know that something doesn't work, so we know not to try and do that thing again. And that really is key. And I think over the past, you know, half hour or so, the two key themes that we always come back to in engineering leadership is around our technical excellence and around our culture and our growth of development. And I suppose from my perspective, to give you a little bit of an insight into what that actually looks like, I can share my experience specifically within the data tribe. So if we look at the technical excellence then, and we work out where we were. So I don't know, maybe about a year ago, all our data was more so in data warehouses, and we weren't really thinking about how we get that into the cloud and all that kind of stuff. But data really does underpin companies and what we can do with that data and how it underpins innovations and disrupting the market with that kind of data. So what we try to do is identify what technological capabilities do we need in order to drive that. So we've done a lot of work around getting new tech in there, such as Kafka, the guys currently working on Kubeflow, Jupyter Notebooks, Seldon, AWS, Azure, all that kind of good stuff. So we need those underlying technical capabilities in order to drive business value. Once we've got those technical capabilities, and it's not just about getting any old tech in there, and just, it doesn't matter if underneath the sink everything's bursting water everywhere. It matters about the way that we do it as well. So we always come back to our technical excellence, trying to instill best practices for our coding standards, branching strategy, our builds, our CI/CD, and trying to make sure that we encourage our people not to just stay in their role, but also to think outside of it. So it comes back to that diverse leadership that we spoke about earlier on. So I know that we've got the engineers that we've been hiring are just absolutely superb, because they don't just build something, they're actually asking the questions. And it's that kind of leadership and culture that we're trying to build. And I think I seen a question on there on the Slido, which was around, why don't we just focus on engineering? Because it needs to be underpinned by both. And that really is our secret to success at Covéa, which is making sure that we focus on these technical capabilities and also the culture and the people, and giving people empowerment to do it. So as I say, with those technical choices that we've made and our architecture and our technical roadmaps coming together, we've now got the foundations that we can really build the future. And one of the key things that I always say to the guys is not necessarily about looking what the competition's doing, because we are much better than that. We don't need to be looking behind us and looking to the side. We need to crack on, because we can blaze the trail. One of the key things that I, you know, say to our team is whenever I ask them, you know, are you having a good day? Or, you know, how's your day? And they just say good. I say, you know, good is not in our vocabulary, because good is average, and we at Covéa are just not average. You know, we might have been there before, but we're not there anymore, because we have made these changes. We have made mistakes. We've learned from those mistakes. And as Paul said, we're never going to get to perfection, because as soon as we get to perfection, we'll realize, oh, there's something else that we can do. And that's one of the key things that I've noticed within the data tribe over this past 7-8 months is a complete change. Now that we've got those technical capabilities and we've got the foundations for success, we can start building up on that. But we can't just do that without looking at the culture. So that some of the culture things that we've been doing within the data tribe are, we're bringing in more engineers with different perspectives. To us, it's not just about a job title, i.e. you've got a data engineer. It's about people that are passionate and people that want to change the game is the people that we're looking for, and that's what we're bringing in, trying to help them settle in by having things like buddy initiatives, so that we actually match them up with someone else in the tribe so that they're feeling welcome and they can start bunching ideas off each other. And specifically in that example, one of the things that we tried to do was not necessarily buddy up someone with, oh, you're in, you know, big data, the cloud, we're going to match you up with someone else in that area. No, we're actually trying to match it with people with different experiences, because it comes back to that diversity and what we're trying to achieve. So as I say, it is trying to get the balance. And I really do feel like, for example, within the data tribe, we are blazing the trail of how we're going to change the insurance market, especially with data and what we can do with that. We're doing a lot of things around creating our data ecosystem to get data in there with these technologies that I mentioned, such as Kafka, Kubeflow, Jupyter Notebooks, and then giving data scientists the ability and the capabilities to actually perform experimental analysis so that we can actually do things like we've got customers calling up constantly to get updates on their insurance or their pet or whatever it might be, but actually via AI and these data science experimentations, we can actually stop that. So therefore driving down costs for our business. So it's not just about we're building nice shiny tech, it's actually linking it back to the business strategy. I'm going to pass over to Paul on our culture, because we kind of touched on a real example there, and we're not just doing that, we're doing a lot of different things. So Paul's going to share some on that.
Yeah, so thanks, Kathleen. The future is exciting for culture as well. So Kathleen mentioned, you know, about new technologies and bringing in people, but we are keen to grow our people as well. So we're embarking on an initiative with North Coders in Leeds and Manchester to help us grow our internal capabilities as well. So people that may have come in as a junior or come up through the ranks, then how do we help them get to be a senior or a lead or even a tech principal in the future? So we're looking to grow that as well. And there's things that we're also looking to do with, I think this is a key thing, is about engaging with our HR and our people support functions to make sure that we're not doing this in silo in engineering. We are maybe blazing the trail, but we're bringing people with us and we're making sure that we've got the right policies and processes in place to reward people, you know, to have some kind of recognition going on, whether that be, I'm not talking about a McDonald's star here, I'm talking, you know, like maybe, you know, like a red letter day once COVID dies down and we can all get out there. But, you know, just like little things like maybe a box of biscuits being sent to your house, or little quizzes and little things that we can do to keep people engaged. And you know, we're in work a long time. So to make it where you feel that you're comfortable and you are respected and you've got that potential to grow and you've got people around you that are all committed and pushing to the same goal, then that makes work a heck of a lot more easier to put your 8-9 hours in a day than it would be if you weren't bought in and you didn't have the support and the right people around you. So I think there's a hell of a lot of there's a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of great exciting things going on, and what we hope to do is, like, next year we come back to this festival and we share some more of the successes and some more of these mistakes that we've made, and we also, you know, we're a very open and inclusive leadership team. So for anyone that may want to connect to us on LinkedIn or things like that, then please feel free to do so and ask any questions that you may have, and or check on our progress and see if we're just there spinning you a yarn or if we're really delivering on what we've said here as well. Some of the other things that we're doing to help change that is, you know, Alex mentioned about the autonomy and empowerment. We're making sure that our people understand what that means, and there's a lot of times where people say about empowerment, but it's about making sure that they understand what their guardrails are, their areas and their frameworks that they can work within. So making sure that that's visible and they understand that is a key thing. So we're still, I think we probably made a mistake with that when we first started it, and we're learning from that and we're readdressing that at the moment. So people understand that, you know, if they are a full stack team, then they can actually deliver on what they need to do. So if we're setting them up to succeed, and they're empowered to change and challenge how we do that. And as a leadership team, we're not there to tell them what to do. We're there to facilitate them doing what they need to do on that time. Have I missed anything, guys?
No, not probably.
I think it's probably
we're always making mistakes.
Yeah, it's probably worthwhile just touching on. We've talked through a lot about bringing technical capabilities and people culture together. One of the things that will be coming very shortly that we'll be looking to trial is something called Sophia. So that's skills framework for the information age. It's a really important thing for us as an engineering function. One of the things about the restructure that I mentioned was it starts to give people different routes that they've never had before. We've now got technical principals, for instance. We never had that role before the before the restructure, which meant all you could do if you wanted to move from a senior was to be a lead engineer. You couldn't go and really focus on something technical. It was always about that kind of management and leadership. Sophia's going to help us escalate that and be really transparent to our people what they need to do to get to where they want to be, whether that be a technical principal, a technical engineering manager, move from junior through those routes. We're trying to enable all of those things for our people. But there's got to be that right balance between what we want to deliver technically and what we want to deliver from a people culture. So that's one of the most important things that we'll be looking to roll out in the next few weeks.
I knew I'd forgot that. Cheers, Alex. Okay, so we've got the Slido Q&A. Open, but so if we just have a look at some of the questions that are on there now, and if anyone's got any questions, then please feel free to put them on there. The code is up in the top right corner, or if we go through the questions, then we'll open the mics and people can ask. So we've got a question here, guys. What is the number one thing you would suggest to help a company move forward? Anyone want to take that?
I can give my view on that. Yep. Firstly, these are great questions. I've been looking at them for the last 10 minutes or so. I think
you've got an answer.
Yeah. In my experience, the things that often cause obstacles to companies working and moving forward is often collaboration. I'll wrap it up in collaboration. So Some of the obstacles that have been caused, and we'll be honest, engineering have probably done this as well, is understanding, you know, what everybody's roles is and where they want to go. Often what you get is, you know, each individual role, if I think of Scrum, I'm very passionate about Scrum. Everybody has a particular role in a Scrum team. So you're either part of the development team, where you may be a tester, a developer, or an analyst, or you're part of the Scrum team, which we then throw the Scrum Masters and product owners in. What seems to happen and causes the most noise is when everybody starts bleeding the lines of their responsibilities. For whatever reason that is, and I've seen this happen, and everybody's doing it for the right reasons. But what that leads to is a misalignment of the organization, because you'll get people wanting to do something, and then other people will say, you can't do that. And then those people will say, you can't. And that collaboration for me is key to aligning every single person to hitting the company's goals. And that is the number one bit of learning that I've taken from the last 12 months. If everybody's not collaborating and aligning to that one company goal, you will never get there. And it's a really important point for me, and something that we're discussing quite a lot at this moment in time internally. You know, again, fail fast. Let's try things, but let's not keep making the same mistakes. And when you're not aligned as a leadership team or a team, you will continue to make the same mistakes.
I think just to add into that, I'm going to be cheesy and quote, which is the title of the talk, which is a little less conversation, a little more action. If you want to make progress, you need to take action. You cannot progress without taking action. Imagine that you're in a football match and the football players just stood with the ball and they're not moving. Then chances are you're likely not going to score that goal, because the ball will be taken off you or you just won't move. It really is key. And sometimes it can be really difficult because you can see where something's going wrong. And it's having that, you know, be bold and be brave. Don't be afraid to step up and say, I don't think something's quite right here. And one of the things that we've been saying, you know, at Covéa, especially within our leadership team, is we need to sometimes slow down to speed up. And it can be really scary to be like, we can't just stop that project that we've been doing for I don't know how many years, but sometimes you just need to pivot and identify where you're trying to go. So setting that direction, setting that collaborative, you know, working environment and creating a culture whereby people can challenge each other is key.
I think for my two pence in this, I think it's about making sure that everyone is clear on what they're here to do and what the company goals are. So if you have a clarity of vision of what you're there as a department, as a company to deliver, then you all know which direction you're pushing in. So to go back to Alex's bit where the lines may bleed between each role, well, if it's clear what each person's role is and they know what that is and they know how they can help other people. So it is important to have a clear role definition. But as Kathleen mentioned, we're not I-shaped people as a leadership function. We're very much T and E-shaped. I don't know what E-shaped is, but I'm not that good at yoga. So, you know, it's good to know where you can help each other. So if everyone stuck to their same discipline, then Scrum wouldn't work. It's about making sure that you can all come together as a team to push forward and deliver. So, but it's making sure you do that in the right way through the collaboration. So you talk to people, you don't just go and do their job. You help them when you can do it. So I think that's what I would say on that one.
Just to add in there, Paul, you were saying you don't know what E-shaped people is. A lot of people, whenever they think about different shaped people, always think about I or T. And E-shaped people are, they've got the experience and they can actually execute. So it's not just someone with, you know, good ideas in one area. It's taking it to that next level. It's got, you know, experience in a few different areas across several areas. They've proven that they can deliver and they're always exploring and innovating, all that kind of good stuff.
Brilliant. You learn something new.
There's a good example of a diverse leadership team working together.
We did not plan that.
So next question we've got on here is, how do you know what capabilities you need? Good question. I think that, I'll start that one if you want. So I think that is understanding what you're trying to deliver. So if you understand what you're trying to deliver, then you should have a good picture of what your base capabilities are in order to need to hit that. But also you should understand what you've currently got in place. So there's no point bringing in lots and lots of new people or setting off in a journey on a tech stack if you haven't got the skills in house to be able to do that. So it goes back to that clarity of vision, but also it's about an honest appraisal of where you are and what you're trying to do. So if you can't embark on a journey, if you don't have the right tools to get there and the right people to help you get there. So I think it's, to me, it's about that honest approach to making sure that you're on the right path and not be afraid to challenge if you don't think it's going well. And then like Kathleen mentioned several times about pivoting, you know, it's like we need to maybe, do we need to change direction? Do we need to approach this from a slightly different way? And having that confidence and lack of fear of failure to do that.
And I think to add to that, over the last 12 months or so, one of the things that's been really important for us to understand capabilities is to listen to people. And that might be our own people. It might be people from outside of engineering, but really listen to what they're telling us. Generally, the people on the ground that we've got are fantastic. You know, I'd trust that I could chuck them into a situation and they'd be able to react because they know what they're doing. Listen to the voices of this is where we are short. We need some support here. Listening to people who are going to set the business strategy. This is where we need to be in 2 years. Okay, well, have a chat. That means this. So therefore, we're a bit short in this area, so let's go out and fill that area. What I've learned over the last 7 years of being in the engineering leadership is you've constantly got to challenge yourself about understanding and listening to get to the right capabilities that you need, whether that's now, 6 months, 12 months, 24 months, doesn't matter. You really need to enable yourself to listen to people to understand what capabilities you need.
We got any more questions on the Slido?
There was one around, should you not focus on engineering and let the business focus on culture? You're quite passionate about that one, Paul.
You can do that. However, I would say that's just enforcing that silo of engineering being separate and the business being separate. Engineering is nothing without its people. So its people is its culture and how we work together. I think that's key. We haven't got to that stage yet where robots and AI can write code that we need. We still need the people to do that. And having that culture and having that understanding of the value of the people that are writing the code and the value of the opinions of those people and how they interact with the business in order to develop and deliver those software products and services out there. I think if you separate culture away from engineering, then you're likely to maybe fail or not deliver the right things. That's my thoughts on it. Engineering is just another function of a business area. So it is part of the business. So its culture is just as valuable as that business culture as well.
And I think this is a great question because, as I alluded to before, we've made some mistakes on this already. So I talk a lot with our architects about personalization to our internal customers. You know, one customer will want something, another customer will want something else. It's no different to the culture that we need to build in engineering. I know a lot of people who really enjoy getting involved in things and shouting and all those wonderful things that you do. I know a lot of people that don't want to be involved in those kinds of things, and that's okay. I think what we're trying to do is get that balance between understanding that we're going to drive that culture that's personalized to our people. We don't want everybody getting involved in everything we do. What we want to do is make that a personal experience to our people. If they want to focus on technology, that's fine. If they want to focus on technology and culture, that's fine. It's that kind of thing that we are working towards as a leadership team, how we challenge ourselves to personalize that culture experience for our people.
I think like the most successful software applications and products out there are things that focus on that customer need and focus on that customer centric, making sure they're delivering an experience that's needed. And I think that's what we're trying to internalize with our people as well, making sure that the experience that every single one of our engineers has is brilliant and they want to grow and develop with us, because that helps them grow and develop as a person. But also, if they're growing and developing, enjoying their job and feel free to innovate, then we're going to deliver quality solutions at the end because they're bought in and invested into what we're doing. So I think that is why that personalization is so special and what we need to help embed continually.
I don't think there's any more questions on there, Paul, but is there results from the poll that there was?
Oh, can I see that, Paul? Yes. So for biggest blocker, or results. So most the highest percentage, 43%, was capability, followed by other. So if anyone would like to elaborate as to what the other is, please feel free. Do we have to take people off mute, or I can't see because I've got the screen on.
I didn't mute and I wanted to start, so I think that they did it themselves. Maybe you can unmute yourself. What's it saying?
So it's adjusting to remote working, even with all the collaborative tools.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've felt that pain as well.
Yeah,
we've had a lot of.
It's been an interesting 6 months or so, hasn't it?
Yeah. And I think that the other poll was around, have delivery demands impacted your ability to build the right engineering culture? We have a resounding 100% as to yes on that one. And I think this is where, you know, things like empowering and enabling people to say no to things is where we need to get to. And that's one thing that we've started definitely in quite recently is to say no. We can't obviously deliver everything, and we need to say no to some things to focus on those priorities. I think I could go on to a big spiel about priorities and essentialism and things like that, but it's making sure that you have one key priority that you are focused on delivering, and then the rest are less than that. Otherwise, everything's priority one, everything needs doing yesterday, and you end up running around being busy and not being smart.
Was there any other questions that might not have came onto Slido but you want to ask? Feel free to ask them or ping them on your chat.
No.
Okay, don't think we're going to have any more questions. So I'm going to recommend we pause there because we'll be right on time anyway for 12 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And as Paul said earlier on, or maybe it was Alex, I can't remember, we are an inclusive leadership team. You know, we really do enjoy talking to people about these kind of things. We enjoy listening to problems, giving, you know, suggestions, what's worked for us, all that kind of stuff. So please do reach out, you know, even if it's just to tell us that, you know, your presentation was this or that. You know, we are very open to feedback on things like that as well. So please do get in touch. We'd love to hear from you. Other than that, if I say one thing, it's take action. You know, if you do one thing, it's that. Have a beautiful day.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.